old world upbringing, superstitious. God, my family's superstitious. I remember once I got my first car, it was a 1984 Celica, Toyota Celica GT Brown, right? Soon as I got it, my father hung a red horn from the rear view mirror of the car, right? Just a red horn dangling. I go, what are you doing? This looks like, it's like it's for the malocchio, the eye. So nobody gives you the eye. I go, what eye? Italians, Sicilians, they believe if somebody looks at you, they could literally give you bad luck just on a look, all right? So now we have to have defense mechanisms, okay? I dated girls who weren't even Italian. They'd get into the car, they're like, why do you have a red pepper hanging from your rearview mirror? What is this all about? And I'd have to explain, nah, it's for the demons, you know? So nobody looks at you and cripples your soul. You don't have that in your family? No? It was all old world. No real medication at the house. I didn't know what was going on. I got a fever. My mother started cutting potatoes, right? She would put slices of potatoes with a rag. I go, don't we have any Tylenol? Why are potatoes on my head? I grew up, I was covered in Vicks. We have vats of Vicks, they would just rub me. They would boil water, they would drop the Vicks in the water, then I would have to hover over the water, right? 183 degrees, breathing. Then a beach towel would come over my head, I'm like, I can't breathe, get it off. They would just hold me there. Stay. I can't breathe. Don't we have halls? We need halls. The world doesn't match my upbringing, okay? I'm here to tell you that. I grew up with an immigrant family. My father's Sicilian, my mother's Italian. I gotta clarify that, all right? Half Sicilian, half Italian. But if you talk to my father, you're Sicilian. Okay, Dad, relax. They instilled work ethic into me at a young age. Young. If you come from immigrants, they don't play around with the work. Okay? I've been working since I've been eight. 8 years old, these people put me to work. I don't know what was going on. I was watching cartoons on a Saturday. My father walked in the living room. He's like, hey, go start a business. Now? They never bought us anything. I come from middle class upbringing. They never bought us anything. They told us who had what we wanted in the neighborhood. I'm like, Dad, can we get a dog? Dog, yeah. Two houses down. They got a dog. You want to pet an animal? You walk two houses down. You pet their dog, and then you come back here and cut my lawn. What? What lawn? Why? What does the lawn have to do with a puppy? What are you talking about? There was no napping growing up. Once you were up, you were up, okay? Not like today where the kids are, I'm gonna go take a nap. The mother's like, that's okay, Justin, go take a nap. You've been up for 2 hours now, you're probably exhausted. So go upstairs, lay down, refresh, and come back down when you're good and ready to operate your day. Not my family, okay? Father been constantly on me, questioning me. I was an altar boy. He questioned that, right? He's like, do they pay you for this at the church? You making any scratch? I had asked the priest for a raise. I said, listen, we know what's going on here. You're collecting a lot of cash during the mass, and nobody's getting a cut. We need something, okay? The priest says, we don't pay for mass. We pay for funerals. I said, then put me on the funeral circuit. I'll start working funerals, okay? That's what I was doing. I was working 3-4 funerals a week. During my lunch hour, I would have to wolf down my lunch, which was impossible to do because I had the Italian lunch, okay? My lunch had to be refrigerated in the teacher's lounge, all right? Or it would spoil. I had to fill out a special form that the school wasn't responsible if the veal piccata spoiled in the refrigerator. All right, I had real silverware. Nobody wanted to trade at lunch. Everybody had like American, you know, ho-ho Twinkies. I said, anybody want some S cookies? I got S cookies. Stella Dora. Nobody wants this. And my mother would say, make sure you dip those in coffee. Coffee. Ma, they don't serve coffee in the lunchroom. I'm in third grade. Oh, I'll pack you some coffee then.
I was well into adulthood before I realized that I was an American. I was born an American and lived here all my life. But somehow it never occurred to me that being a citizen of the United States meant that I was an American. Americans were people who ate bland, plain food. Me? I was Italian. For me, as I am sure for most second-generation Italian-American kids who grew up in the 50s and 60s, there was a definite distinction drawn between us and them. We were Italians. Everybody else, the Irish, Germans, Polish, Jewish, they were the Americanes. There was no animosity involved in this distinction, no prejudice, no hard feelings. Just, well, you know, they were not like us. Our ways were different. Americans went to the supermarket to buy their food. What a waste. It was their loss. They never enjoyed the pleasure of a fresh, crisp loaf. We stopped at the bakery for fresh Italian bread. Somehow, by the time we got home, the end of the bread was always missing. When you got home, there were meatballs frying in the oil. Nothing tastes better than fried meatballs and crisp Italian bread dipped into a pot of gravy. There was another big difference between us and the Americanes. We had gardens. Not just flower gardens, but gardens where we grew tomatoes, basil, peppers, arugula, squash, and more tomatoes. Of course, our gardens thrived as they did because we had something else our American friends didn't have. We had grandmas. It's not that they didn't have grandmothers. It's just that their grandmothers didn't live in the same house or on the same block or in the same neighborhood. They visited their grandmothers. We lived with ours. And God forbid you didn't check in with Grandma at least once a day. I can still remember Grandma telling us about when she came to America on the boat and how life was when they first arrived and what it took to raise 4 boys and 4 girls in a small apartment. Of course, she told us all of this in her own version of Italian English, which we all learned to understand quite well. When my grandparents saved enough money and no one could figure out how they did it, they bought a house. And that house served as the family headquarters for the next 30 years. I remember how much Grandma hated to leave that house. She would rather sit on the back porch and watch the garden grow. But when she did leave for a special occasion, she would return home as quickly as possible because she said nobody was watching the house. I also remember the holidays when the whole family would gather at Grandma's house. There were tables full of food, homemade wine, raviolis, and music. Women in the kitchen with their holiday aprons on. Men in the living room and kids everywhere. I must have 1,000 cousins, first cousins, second cousins, and some who aren't even related, but it didn't matter. My grandma would sit in the middle of all of this and smile, her dark eyes twinkling, surveying her domain. She was proud of her family and how well her children had done. Her sons all had good jobs, and her daughters all married hard-working men who were good providers. And everyone knew respect. She had achieved her goal in coming to America, and now her children and her grandchildren were achieving their goals in this great country because they were Americans. When my grandmother died at a ripe old age, things began to change. Family gatherings were fewer, and something seemed to be missing. Although, when the family did get together, I always had the feeling that Grandma was there. These days, we mostly see each other at weddings and wakes. Lots of other things have changed, too. The front door on the old house where Grandma lived is now covered by a wrought iron gate. The gardens are gone. The wine cellar is empty. Now, on the holidays, there are no more rounds, visiting family, only occasional trips to the cemetery where my grandparents and many of my uncles and aunts lie. The holidays have changed, too. The great quantity of food we once consumed without any ill effects is supposedly no good for us anymore. Too much starch, too much sugar, too much cholesterol, too many calories. Nobody bakes. Everybody is too busy, and it's easier to get it at the store. The difference between us and the Americanos isn't so easily defined anymore. And maybe that's good. My grandparents were Italian Italians. My parents were Italian Americans. I'm an American Italian. And my kids are American Americans. Oh, I'm American, all right. Just as my grandma would have wanted me to be. But somehow, I still feel Italian. What is it? Maybe it's the culture, the tradition, roots. I'm not exactly sure what it is, but I try to pass it on to my children. Oh, I guess all I do know is that somehow my children have been cheated out of a wonderful piece of their great Italian heritage. They never knew my grandma.
In the early 1900s, four DeMilo children left their homeland, their parents, and their family to seek a better future. Amidst the prevailing discrimination against Southern Italian immigrants in America, they prevailed by working hard, honoring their new homeland, and educating their children. How did it start? Where did we originally come from? Were we always in Marignano? If not, where? And what does our last name mean? 24 miles southwest of Rimini is a small mountain valley town called Maiole, primarily known for its bicycle racing routes, but years ago was known for a legendary landslide which destroyed the original walled city of Maiole. The devastating landslide of May 28, 1700 killed most of the residents of Maiole and left only four houses and two towers standing. Sometime between 1400 and 1700, one or more of our ancestors traveled 310 miles south from the town of Maiole to the town of Bruciano. Surnames were not adopted until around 1450 in Italy, and even then, only by the aristocracy. A person was known by combining his first name with that town or city where he was from, or his trade, or color of his hair, etc. In our instance, the surname became Di Maiole, from the town of Maiole. In 1856, Nicola Di Maiole settled in Marillinella, a small suburb of Marigliano, and married Anna Seppe. Their son was Vincenzo, who married Mariana Carpino.
Their children were Nicola, Mariana, Margarita, Francesco, Felice, Maria, and Rosa. Remaining in Italy with their parents were Rosa and Maria. Maria married Pasquale Ottaiano. Their children were Giuseppe, Domenico, Consiglia, Margherita, Carmela, and Mariana, who married Giuseppe Tramontano. Maria passed away at age 37 in 1938. Carmela died at age 15 in 1944, and Giuseppe died at age 23 in 1947. Rosa became caretaker for her nieces and nephews when Maria died. Since Pasquale, a road engineer for Mussolini, worked a lot in North Africa. Eventually, Pasquale and Rosa married so that there'd be no wagging tongues in the village of Marillinella. Naples was the most bombed city throughout all of Italy during the war. Our family lived through immense devastation, poverty, and lack of food and medicines, just as all Neapolitans did during those terrible years. When Giuseppe was 18 years old and studying to become a lawyer, the Germans forcibly took him to work for the German army and shipped him to Milan, a distance of 486 miles from Marillinella. On three different occasions, Giuseppe ran away and came back home, walking, getting rides from farmers on their wagons, asking for food. On the third and last time, the Germans were hunting down escapees and executing them. It was nearing the end of the war, but Giuseppe was not aware of it. He could not risk being seen, so he hid during the day and traveled by foot at night, keeping alive by eating berries, roots, and whatever he could find to stay alive. The war was now over, but Giuseppe didn't know it, because he was traveling at night alone and being very careful not to be seen by anyone. It took Giuseppe over a month to get home. He was frail and very sick. He arrived home sometime in 1946. Aunt Rosa contacted Aunt Anna Bonacontri in America, pleading for penicillin for Giuseppe. And somehow, Aunt Anna got some of it and sent it. However, mail to Europe after the war was difficult and very slow. By the time the penicillin arrived, it was too late. Giuseppe passed away at age 23, 1947.
It felt so good after so many years to see all the family, and it caused a few tears, to see all the aunts, the uncles, the cousins, sisters, brothers, and kids by the dozens. We brought memories back and remembered old names. We went back in time, even replayed old games. Red Rover, let Charlie come over. Or remembering the time you hit that long homer. But at this reunion, there was a special surprise. Joey and Laura opened everyone's eyes when all at once they appeared in a group. It's a wedding party. The family was duped. As tears of joy ran down Jenny's face, we all wished them happiness, love, and God's grace. We then took some photos of the young and the old. Some are a bit grayer, if truth to be told, and some of us lost a step in our walk, while the youngsters wonder why we just sit and we talk. Now time for more photos of all generations, while we listen to Vinny's dire lamentations. I'm in the front row? Oh no, not me. So now as I gaze at our family tree, I see many names no longer with me. I honor those names, both old and new, and I pray that our children will honor them too. And now, as we part, for only a while, I'll leave with a hug, a kiss, and a smile, to know that no matter how far we're apart, you always will have us all in your heart. We'll be together soon, I know. Until then, sit back, watch this family grow.
The bay. under their memory. Now all your children of Italy, fill in and cherish your family tree from the Bay of Napoli. Being the children of Italy, there was Frank and Phil and Anna and Nick. They all came here to be free. They all